I said, again, for those who hate it, I could not respect your opinion more. And for those who love it, I question your sanity.
It seems to be universally agreed upon that the Disney sequel trilogy was a bit of a mess. Even the sequel fans agreed that the trilogy as a whole is not a coherent piece of work. This, coupled with the struggle for uniqueness and innumerable plot holes, have left a bitter taste in the mouth of fans. The Force Awakens was the first film to release within the saga since 2005, and it was one of the most anticipated returns to any franchise ever. With the pressure of trying to please everyone, and with Disney trying to make the most money without taking too much risk, J.J. Abrams decided to create a film as close to A New Hope as possible instead of expanding the story where Return of the Jedi left off. This is especially upsetting due to the fact that George Lucas had given them his scripts for 7, 8, and 9.
So they decided they didn't want to use those stories. They decided they were going to go do their own thing, and so I decided, fine, but basically, I'm not going to try to... They weren't that keen to have me involved anyway, but at the same time, I said, I'm not going to... If I get in there, I'm just going to cause trouble, because they're not going to do what I want them to do, so... And I don't have the control to do that anymore, and all I would do is muck everything up. So I said, okay, I will go my way, and I'll let them go their way.
I imagine that Disney didn't want to take a risk on what could be something as divisive as George's last work in the saga, the prequel trilogy. Upon release of The Force Awakens, a lot of fans were excited about the future possibilities that the movie had presented, but many were disappointed with the uncreativity. For example, the hero is a lonely, force-strong desert dweller. A droid with secret information is on the run from a dark side user. There's a corrupt empire being controlled by a mysterious and powerful villain. The hero watches from afar as their mentor is slain by someone they used to care for. There's a moon. Wait, that's no moon.
It's a space station.
And yes, both do blow up. It doesn't take a long time to notice how identical this movie is to its inspiration. And if you look to the rest of the trilogy, you will find these similarities in each and every scene. Some people may not like the prequel trilogy, but at least they were each unique and added to the story as a whole. One of the other reasons I have problems with this trilogy is the total amount of canon-breaking plot holes, which is what you get when you don't plan your story out. To begin, how is the First Order in power of the galaxy? Hasn't the New Republic just been created? Also, Luke leaves to his exile hoping to never be found, and yet he leaves a map to his location. What? Okay, and The Last Jedi's Haldo maneuver has become one of the dumbest scenes within Star Wars. Within this scene, Admiral Haldo uses the ship's lightspeed function to cut through the entire shielded enemy fleet and destroy most of it while sacrificing herself in the process. I admit it looks very cool, but if this can be done within Star Wars, why not send an unmanned ship into the Death Star to destroy it with ease? This could have been done in many space battles when knowing which ship the enemy commander is on. And earlier in that movie, Luke remembers trying to kill Ben in his sleep when he dreamt of him falling to the dark side, yet that is something Luke would never do. As he laid down his life in the off chance that his murderer father would be saved. In The Rise of Skywalker, when Palpatine is brought back, his response to Hao is Sith magic, but he clearly states within Revenge of the Sith that he doesn't actually know how to bring back Padme, but that they'll figure it out together. Yo, trust Vader, trust. And if they had, don't you think Vader would have brought back Padme at that point? Also, why is Palpatine using his second Death Star at all if he has a fleet of planet-destroying weapons? It ruins the stakes of the battle and makes many lines of dialogue confusing. If Vader knew about them, why didn't he tell Luke? Oh, Luke, there's also 1,000 of the Death Stars. Also, how is the second Death Star mostly intact? The energy levels within a planet-destroying weapon should reduce it to tiny atoms. and this is assumed to be the case when watching the original trilogy. A dagger is also randomly procured from a pit they fall into because they get shot at the perfect time while they're riding on the speeder at the perfect place and they fly the perfect trajectory. Okay. And the dagger lines up perfectly with all the ridges of the supposed intact Death Star that hasn't weathered or fallen apart at all. And in order for the dagger to work, you need to be standing within a few feet from the spot they decided to stop at. Don't you love the quality of writing? The Rise of Skywalker also introduces force healing. Although force healing to a small extent has been within games and novels for a while now, there was no way to be able to revive someone from a fatal injury, as this could have then been used to save Qui-Gon Jinn and many others. Also, Force Ghosts can now use lightning and pick up lightsabers. Okay, then let's just give the rest of the Force Ghosts lightsabers and go kill any Sith. And if Palpatine can come back from the dead, why can't he just come back after being killed by Rey? When he's threatened by Kylo, he says, "I've been killed before." This movie makes no sense, oh my gosh. But to me, the worst one is that the whole point of the saga and the whole point of Anakin's arc is that he is the Chosen One and that he would finally bring balance to the Force. Finally, at the end of the sixth film, he does, by killing Palpatine and saving his son. Yeah, this is thrown out the window because...
somehow Palpatine returned.
The ability to speak does not make you intelligent.
When taking control of something as gargantuan as the Star Wars saga, you'd assume that plans would be put in place to track out and map the future of the franchise. Alas, the situation at Disney couldn't be further from that truth. J.J. Abrams was the director, writer, and producer for The Force Awakens and The Rise of Skywalker. He spent the years preceding the release of The Force Awakens by planning a singular story based on tropes from the original trilogy in hopes of nostalgia baiting the fans, but we'll talk more about that later. Once The Force Awakens released, amid massive box office success and mixed critical reviews, he planned on waiting until the second film was greenlit before he added on to the story. This was problematic due to the fact that not starting the saga with a full plan on the trilogy would lead to disjointed parts and a non-coherent story. This became even more troublesome when the second part, The Last Jedi, was announced to be led by Rian Johnson, who has an obsession with inserting subverted expectations into anything he touches. So instead of following where JJ left off, Rian spun a 180 on the saga and created something no one expected nor few wanted. This was not for the better, as many fans felt betrayed and confused as to where their childhood story was heading. For example, within the film,
maybe he's Jake Skywalker, he's not my Luke Skywalker,
who had only briefly cameoed in the film preceding it, seemed to be a totally different person that the fans had grown to love.
I said to Rian, I said, Jedis don't give up. I mean, even if he had a problem, he would maybe take a year to try and regroup. But if he made a mistake, he would try and right that wrong. So right there, we had a fundamental difference. But it's not my story anymore. It's somebody else's story. And Rian needed me to be a certain way to make the ending effective. That's the crux of my problem. Luke would never say that.
Obsessed with trying to achieve uniqueness, Rian Johnson had forgotten what Star Wars is all about. Having greatly shaken the faith of the fans, much pressure was put on J.J. Abrams to save the trilogy. Having relatively not much to work with coming off The Last Jedi, J.J. Abrams decided to go big, for better or for worse. Palpatine had returned. The release of The Rise of Skywalker was met with box office success, but with a shaken fandom. And to be honest, most people after watching the film were just happy that it was far and away from the likes of The Last Jedi. But as time wore on, the novelty of the conclusion to the saga wore off and people began to see how disjointed the film truly was. The three films almost have nothing in common, and truly show what a lack of management and planning can do to an otherwise exciting prospect. When creating a sequel trilogy, Disney has some questionable incentives. Of course, making movies partially for money and marketing is needed in order to create a profit, but sacrificing the purity of a story and arguably the biggest IP ever in order to play it safe? Come on, I was hoping for some new Star Wars, not a rebrand for a money grab. Racial diversity is a great thing for film, and Disney agrees in that it makes money. This was shown back when The Force Awakens was marketed to audiences all over the world, and the posters for a few countries differed. These posters and trailers shown within the United States and surrounding countries are identical, and present Finn in a very compelling way, which no doubt drove ticket sales to a certain degree. Whereas the one in China shows a major change. Yes, they shrunk Finn. Hoping to pass him off as a minor character, they appealed more to the social norms within the Chinese borders. Disney used John Boyega mainly for monetary purposes and could care less about his story and representation. The Knights of Ren. Fierce, interesting, and never explained. The Knights of Ren are one of the biggest wasted opportunities within the films, as they had such a presence from the first film, only to be unused until their demise in the finale. Also, imagine Finn as the main character, a stormtrooper that leaves the Empire only to find out he's force sensitive, gets trained by Luke Skywalker, and defeats evil alongside him. Think back. What was the loudest moment in the theater when you watched the sequels? I can guarantee you that it was not the union of Han, Luke, and Leia, because it never happened. How? How can you not see the value in such a scene? That would be Disney's last chance to do it now that Carrie Fisher has passed on. They had one chance and they wasted it, which seems to be a recurring theme. The sequel trilogy is a wasted opportunity, plain and simple. Although I respect your opinion if you enjoy one or more of the films, it's hard not to imagine what could have been. Well, thank you all for watching, and may the Force be with you. Always.